a year of release. How many people need a year of release? Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. Come on.
Yes.
Okay. All right. So we're going to begin with the blowing of the shofar. If you could open this. Thank you. All right.
Trespasses to pass away.
wait year by year, King over all the earth, who sanctifies the Sabbath and Israel and the Day of Atonement. We have trespassed, we have been faithless, we have robbed, we have spoken basely, we have committed iniquity, we have wrought unrighteousness, we have been presumptuous, we have done violence, we have forged lies, we have counseled evil, we have spoken falsely, we have scoffed, we have revolted, we have blasphemed, we have been rebellious, we have acted perversely, we have transgressed, we have persecuted, we have been stiff-necked, we have done wickedly, we have corrupted ourselves, we have committed abomination, we have gone astray, and we have led astray. For the sin which we have committed before thee under compulsion or of our own will, and for the sin which we have committed before thee in hardening of the heart, for the sin which we have committed before thee unknowingly, and for the sin which we have committed before thee with utterance of the lips, for the sin which we have committed before thee by unchastity, and for the sin which we have committed before thee openly and secretly, for the sin which we have committed before thee knowingly and deceitfully, and for the sin which we have committed before thee by the sinful inclinations of the heart. Thou knowest the secrets of eternity and the most hidden mysteries of all living. Thou searchest the innermost recesses and tryest the reins and the heart. Naught is concealed from thee or hidden from thine eyes. May it then be thy will, O Yahweh our God and God of our fathers, to forgive us for all our sins, to pardon us for all our iniquities, and to grant us remission for all our transgressions.
And everyone says,
Amen.
Our next prayer is going to be a prayer for the nation. Prayers against terrorism. I bind and rebuke every religion of terror that will come against my nation in the name of Yeshua. I will not be afraid of the terror by night. I bind and rebuke all terrorists that will plot against my nation in the name of Yeshua. I bind and rebuke all spirits of hatred and murder that will manifest through terrorism in the name of Yeshua. I bind and rebuke all religious terrorists in the name of Yeshua. I bind and rebuke all demons of jihad in the name of Yeshua. I bind and rebuke all spirits of antichrist and hatred of Christianity in the name of Yeshua. I bind all spirits of hatred of America in the name of Yeshua. I bind and rebuke the terrors of death in the name of Yeshua. I bind all fear and panic that would come through terrorism in the name of Yeshua. Deliver me from violent and bloodthirsty men. I cut the acts of violence out of the hands of the wicked. Let the assemblies of violent men be exposed and cut off. Let violence be no more in my borders.
Hallelujah!
May it be your will, Yahweh our Elohim and Elohim of our fathers, that for the sake of your holy and pure name that comes forth from the Pasuk, Hashem will fight for you, and you shall be silent, that you give to our soldiers and all those who support your people of Israel power and success to be victorious in all matters, that their words be heard, that they be wise, that they dominate in every conflict and every justice. shortcomings. We have prayed for the nation, and we have prayed for Israel. Okay, now we can go forth before God and let's really enjoy. And this is to be a season of enjoyment. We were discussing before, okay, everyone came in from Zechariah chapter 8, verse 19. You don't have to turn to it. Thus says Yahweh Zebaoth, the fast of the fourth month, the fast of the fifth, and the fast of the seventh. This is the fast of the seventh, and the fast of the tenth. Shall be to the house of Judah joy and gladness and cheerful feast. Therefore, love the truth and peace. So this for us is a time of rejoicing, because Yom Kippur is one of the feasts that Yeshua filled upon the cross, okay, as being that scapegoat, being the Lamb of God who takes away our sin. And as the theme of this Yom Kippur, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Hallelujah. All right, you may be seated. All right, our first reader, everyone has this. Oh, no. Okay, we have Brad with the song and then Miss Jenny with the prayer book.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
All right, hallelujah.
We give God all the glory, honor, and praise, because he's an awesome God.
Yes, he is.
Hallelujah. 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 Praise his name.
Psalms 33. But you, O Yahweh, are a shield for me, my glory, and the one who lifts up my head.
Yes.
Psalm 27:6, and now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies all around me. Therefore, I will offer sacrifices of joy in his tabernacle. I will sing, yes, I'll sing praises to Yahweh.
Amen, hallelujah, come on, let's go. You know how I roll for show, for a rap ministry on the go. We believe the pursuing Yahweh will, to bring the truth for the Lord that's so real. Shine some light in the dark, you succeed. Look around, you got many enemies. They won't let up, they keep on attacking me. I look to my father who died on the tree. What about all the things that we've done? It doesn't matter, you'll take you to the kingdom. Walk the blood, your life is quite clean. A new day, a new way, all right, King. So it's time, you give your life. Quiet, Proverbs 31, I found me a good way. Now I'm back, the roof has shown me. Now I'm ready, my journey begins.
Yeah.
hands up. Put your hands up and reach the sky. Look up. Give thanks to the Most High. Put your hands up. Put your hands up. Send them up. Praise God. Put your hands up. Put your hands up and reach the sky. Look up. Give thanks to the Most High.
You know
what
I'm
saying?
Says this to the mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Therefore, I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. Do not turn and run when you are facing a mountain. Stand and face your mountain and command, be thou removed.
Yes.
Rejoice when your faith is tested by the mountains of adversity. For the genuineness of your faith is much more precious than gold, and you shall receive the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Father, we decree and declare that by faith we will face the mountains of sickness and adversity in our lives, and will command that they be removed. Because you have anointed us, we have faith and do not doubt that we can speak to any illness, curse it at the root, and cause it to be removed. We can tell the mountain of sickness that it is in our way and must move and be cast into the sea.
Yes.
And it shall be done.
Amen.
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 Amen. We forget that we have power in the Holy Spirit. Okay, how are you going to know God is a healer if you have never experienced an illness that he healed you? How are you going to practice? God does not inflict illness. Understand something. God does not inflict illness on anyone so he can test them. Understand? That's like, I'm going to stick my child's hand in the fire just so he can experience hot. Okay? God does not do that. However, our lifestyles, different situations, you go into an area, okay, where there is sickness, you know, viruses like the Ebola, things like that, going to help people, and illness may come upon you. So situations sometimes allow illnesses to come upon you. Always remember, the enemy is at the root of illness, but certain things in our lives can contribute to us becoming ill. However, God always has created the cure before the disease. He is the lamb slain before the foundation of the world. So those who are his, understand, in the sky it shows, okay, that there is this lamb that is slain, okay? He gave us a promise through Abraham, and we as heirs of Abraham, yes, we can speak to a mountain, one of those mountains. That's what Torah is all about, the mountain.
Yes,
so when
yes,
you go into that yes, mountain, you can speak to whatever mountain of adversity.
Yes.
You have the ability to curse any illness
yes,
at the root and
yes,
watch that mountain
yes,
be cast
yes,
into
yes,
the sea.
Yes.
Watch that disease dry up.
Yes.
And then it's all a matter of following once again the Torah. He said, go and do what? Sin no more, less what? A worse thing comes upon you. That worse thing is death. Okay? So, we're going to go ahead and begin our... Is Christiana online? Are our people from Minnesota online? Star 6. right. We will come back to Minnesota. All right. Andrea, are you still online? And unmute your phone. Star 6.
Yes, Pastor, I am still online.
Okay. Andrea and I were having a very interesting conversation the other evening. So, Andrea, would you relate to them, okay, what we were talking about with the deaf ministry and your experience and everything and what is going on right now that we discussed the other night?
Wow. Well,
Andrea has been interpreting the services for some deaf. I did not know that she was, okay, a signer. Okay, you remember, okay, that was one of the ministries that I was over in the United Pentecostal Church. And when we first started, me and the Floodmobile, you remember my white van, would be going up to, off of Fletcher, I think it was Fletcher and 15th. Okay, there is a whole deaf ministry up there. And at that point, Tiffany, okay, was very much involved with the deaf ministry. And the Lord had given me a word for the deaf ministry back in 2000, which I had shared, okay, about them being a people. Okay, they are a people. And so often when Christians do not understand that every deaf person doesn't feel like there's something wrong with them and you need to correct them by, you know, laying hands on them and helping them hear. In a lot of cases, that is an insult. Okay, that is an insult, okay, to them. And the insight that Yah gave me when I took over that ministry is that a deaf person is not distracted by all the noise of the world, and they can be more effective by hearing his voice.
Yes.
Okay, yes. Okay, they are a people. Okay, now there are those who are deaf who want to hear. Nothing wrong with that. But there are those who are deaf who say, I am perfect the way I am. And as the Creator creates people for different reasons also, and I respect that. Okay, so the mistake we often make is running up to someone, laying laying hands on them and then wondering why, you know, their ears don't pop open and all that kind of stuff. Okay, that is a way to turn a person off towards God if you don't understand and God give you wisdom. So you pray when you are dealing with different people that God give you wisdom on how to deal with them. And I feel one of the final frontiers is when the deaf hear. But the church interprets that they got to hear our voice. No, when the deaf hear his voice. When the deaf go forth, okay, hearing the voice of the Torah speaking to them. So this is why, and with the Facebook, okay, they have deaf people who are watching this. Andrea said, we need an interpreter here so that if we're on Facebook, the services can be interpreted into their language. See, some of you think the gift of tongues and interpretation is all about what you're speaking with your mouth, but the hands give a language to a people. And everyone should be able to hear the good news of the gospel in the language God has given them. Okay, so Yah is giving Andrea favor now. And we were talking about, I said, well, how come live streaming doesn't have closed captioning? Okay, just like, okay, the television and all that. So that's one project that she's going to be working on. However, the deaf, once again, have their own language. So we do need interpreters because it's not straight English, okay, all the time. So, you know, just pray for continued favor and the resources, okay, that are needed, okay, so that we can get this deaf ministry where it needs to be. All right. Thank you very much for sharing that. Katrina, are you online? Katrina, and then Rich will be next.
Yes,
ma'am. Okay, Katrina, could you begin reading from Leviticus?
Shall bring the bullock of the sin offering, which is for himself, and shall make an atonement for himself and for his house, and shall kill the bullock of the sin offering, which is for himself. And he shall take a censer full of burning coals of fire from off the altar before the Lord, and his hands full of sweet incense beaten small, and it shall be within the veil. And he shall put the incense upon the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of incense may cover the mercy seat that is upon the testimony, that he die not. And he shall take the blood of the bullock and sprinkle it with his finger upon the mercy seat eastward. And before the mercy seat. He shall sprinkle of the blood with his finger 7 times. Then shall he kill the goat of sin offering that is for the people, and bring his blood within the veil, and do with that blood as he did with the blood of the bullock, and sprinkle it upon the mercy seat and before the mercy seat. And he shall make an atonement for the holy place because of the uncleanness of the children of Israel, and because of their transgressions and all their sins. And so shall he do for the tabernacle of the congregation that remaineth among them in the midst of their uncleanness. And there shall be no man in the tabernacle of the congregation when he goeth in to make an atonement in the holy place until he come out and have made an atonement for himself and for his household, for all the congregation of Israel. And he shall go out unto the altar that is before the Lord, and make an atonement for it, and shall take of the blood of the bullock, and of the blood of the goat, and put it upon the horns of the altar round about. And he shall sprinkle of the blood upon it with his finger 7 times, and cleanse it, and hallow it from the uncleanness of the children of Israel. When he hath made an end of reconciling the holy place and the tabernacle of the congregation and the altar, he shall bring the live goat. And Aaron shall lay both his hands upon the head of the live goat and confess over him all the iniquities of the children of Israel and all their transgressions and all their sins, putting them upon the head of the goat, and shall send him away by the hand of a fit man into the wilderness.
All right, is Stephanie available?
Yes, can you hear me?
Okay, yes.
Leviticus, good morning. Leviticus 16, 23 through 34. And Aaron shall go into the tent of meeting, take off the linen vestments that he put on when he entered the shrine, and leave them there. He shall bathe his body in water in the holy precinct, and put on his vestments. Then he shall come out, and after his burnt offering of the people, making expiation for himself and for the people, the fat of the sin offering he shall turn into smoke on the altar. He who said the AGA will go free shall wash his clothes and bathe in his water, body in water. After that, he may re-enter the camp. The bull of sin offering and the goat of sin offering, whose blood was brought into the shrine, shall be taken out outside the camp, and their hides, flesh, and dung shall be consumed in the fire. He who burned up shall wash his clothes and bathe his body in water. After that, he may re-enter the camp. And this shall be to you a law for all time. In the seventh month, on the 10th day of the month, you shall practice self-denial. And you shall do no manner of work, neither the citizen nor the alien who resides among you. For on this day of atonement shall be made for you to cleanse you, shall cleanse you from all of your sins. You shall be clean before the Lord. Shall be a Sabbath, sweet rest for you, and you shall practice self-denial. It is the law for all time. The priest who has been anointed and ordained to serve as priest in the place of his father shall make expiation. Shall put on linen vestments, sacral vestments, and he shall purge the innermost shrine. He shall purge the tent of meeting and the altar, and he shall make expiation for the priest and for the people of the congregation. This shall be to you law for all time, and to make atonement for the Israelites, for their sins once a year, and Moses did as the Lord commanded.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you. Before we go to the next set of scriptures, I wanted to go over a couple of scriptures to make it very relevant for you. Go to Leviticus chapter 16, verse 8 and 9. This is where it comes, where you should be able to understand that Yeshua fulfilled the Torah. And how did he fulfill the Torah? The Torah was the goal, okay, pointing towards him. It gives you the blueprint that was pointing towards him. So on the cross, I want you to think about Leviticus 16, verse number 8. And Aaron shall cast lots upon the two goats, one lot for Yahweh, the other for the scapegoat. And Aaron shall bring the goat upon which Yahweh's lot fell and offer him for a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell to be the scapegoat shall be presented alive before Yahweh to make an atonement with him and to let him go for a scapegoat into the wilderness. At the crucifixion, I'm going to just read from John chapter 18, verses 39 and 40, so you can see this. Yeshua is before Pilate. Pilate says, "But ye have a custom that I should release unto you one at the Passover. Will ye therefore that I release unto you the King of the Jews?" In other words, there are two there. Okay? And how do they respond? "No, not this man, but Barabbas." Okay? So therefore, remember, the Torah says that there are two goats. One is offered up for a sin offering. The other one is let go. So at the crucifixion, there was a custom to let one of the prisoners go. Two, once again. One gets offered up, all right, and the other one is let go. Do you think it is any accident that you call his name Barabbas, right? But it's really Bar-Abbas. Bar being son Abbas, the father. I want you to think about how profound that name is. Who is Yeshua called? Son of the Father. Okay, so you understand the significance even there at the cross that is really missed. That this is how, once again, he fulfills the Yom Kippur sacrifices by being the lot's chosen. Once again, do we choose this one? Do we choose that one? Which one is offered up? Yeshua is offered up. And Barabbas is set free. Go to verse number 21. Leviticus 16, verse 21. And it says, "And Aaron shall lay both his hands upon the head of the live goat and confess over him all the iniquities of the children of Israel and all their transgressions and all their sins, putting them upon the head of the goat, and shall send him away by the hand of a man fit into the wilderness, and the goat shall bear upon him all their iniquities into a land not inhabited, and he shall let go the goat in the wilderness." Okay? Above that, it talks about how killing the goat, verse number 15, "Then shall he kill the goat of the sin offering that is for the people, and bring his blood within the veil, and to do that the blood, as he did with the blood of the bullock, and sprinkle it upon the mercy seat and before the mercy seat, and he shall make an atonement." So you see how, if you confess your sin, he is faithful and just to do what? Forgive your sin and cleanse you from all righteousness. That's why there is salvation in none other than Yeshua. Why? Because he was what? The Lamb of God to take away the sin of the world. And that's what's done during Yom Kippur. That is not what's done during Passover. Passover is about redemption and deliverance. Yom Kippur is about the removal of sin. So we say Yeshua HaMashiach the same yesterday, today, and forever, which means he's in your past, present, and future, fulfilling all of that all at the same time, all right? So it is important when people ask you why you are here, you need to ask them, why aren't you coming with me? Okay? Literally, when you understand what Yom Kippur is all about, it is a day of rejoicing because Yeshua HaMashiach fulfilled all of this.
is rent in twain, and we can go boldly before that veil, okay, at this point, and make our, okay, our request known unto God. So this is how this is applied towards today, so that you understand the reason that you are here is celebrating that it is finished. It is finished, and you are victorious. All right, who do we have? Okay, next scriptures up will be, let's see, do we have Minnesota on yet? All right, Star 6, I don't know if they are online. They may be on Facebook. If they are on Facebook, maybe put a comment in so that Brad can see that you guys are online and somebody could possibly get on the phone. Otherwise, I do need a reader. I do need a reader. Michael, don't look away. Michael, come on up here and read it. Okay, these scriptures. Okay, you don't need, it's right in your booklet. And it will be Leviticus 23, verses 26 through 32. Leviticus 23, verses 26 through 32.
And the Lord spake to Moses, saying, also on the 10th day, it is 7th month, that there should be a day of atonement. It should be a holy convocation unto you, and ye shall afflict your souls. And the offering, and the offer, an offering made by fire unto the Lord. And ye shall do no work in the same day, for it is a day of atonement, to make an atonement for you before the Lord your God. For whosoever soul it be, it shall not be afflicted in the same day. He shall be cut off from among his people. And also, and whatsoever soul it be that does any work in that same day, the same soul will I destroy among the people. Ye shall do no work. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations and all your dwellings. It shall be unto you Sabbath of rest, and ye shall afflict your souls in the ninth day of the month at evening, from even until evening shall ye celebrate your Sabbath.
Shalom. Y el Señor habló a Moisés diciendo, a los 10 días de este 7º mes será el día de la expiación, será santa convocación para vosotros, y humillareis vuestras almas y presentareis una ofrenda encendida al Señor. Tampoco haréis ningún trabajo en este día, porque es día de expiación, para hacer expiación por vosotros delante del Señor vuestro Dios. Si alguna persona no se humilla en este mismo día, será cortado de su pueblo. Y a cualquier persona que haga trabajo alguno en este mismo día, a esa persona la exterminaré de entre su pueblo. No haréis pues trabajo alguno. Estatuto perpetuo será para vuestras generaciones donde quiera que habéis. Será el día de completo reposo para vosotros, y humillaréis vuestras almas. A los 9 días del mes por la tarde, de una tarde a otra tarde, guardaréis vuestro reposo.
Leviticus 25:8-13.
thou shalt number 7 Sabbaths of years unto thee. 7 times 7 years, and the space of 7 Sabbaths of the years shall be unto thee 49 years. Then shalt thou cause the trumpet of the Jubilee to sound on the 10th day of the 7th month. In the Day of Atonement shall ye make the trumpet sound throughout all your land. And ye shall hallow the 50th year, and proclaim liberty throughout all the land unto all the inhabitants thereof. It shall be a Jubilee unto you. And ye shall return every man unto his possession, and ye shall return every man unto his family. A Jubilee shall that 50th year be unto you. Ye shall not sow, neither reap that which groweth of it of itself in it, nor gather the grapes in it, or thy vine undressed. For it is the Jubilee, it shall be holy unto you. Ye shall eat the increase thereof out of the field. In the year of this Jubilee ye shall return every man unto his possession.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Christiana, are you on?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Hallelujah. That's Minnesota, guys. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Give my hand clap. Come on now. Christiana to share her trip to Ethiopia that they just came back from, that we were talking, that Pastor Millie, you know, said that they were going on. So, Christiana, would you share that with us, please?
Yes. Thank you very much. Thank you for giving me the time. Praise the Lord, please. We went into Ethiopia, and that was, we just came back last week. And we had a three-day evangelistic conference out there, and the wonders of God was awesome. It was awesome. And we had 6,000 people all today inside the church to listen to the gospel of God. And outside the church, in the overflow area, we had 3,500 people just sitting out there and listening. And in all 3 days, we had 71 people that came to the Lord and joined the church. Praise the Lord. And we had 17 people that was under demonic strongholds that got delivered. And 29 people rededicated their lives to the Lord. They were baptized and they came back to the Lord. There were many sick people that were healed. People with back problems were healed. We had a girl that was there with a goiter, and as what the God was going on, the goiter just shrunk, and she got healed, praise God.
Hallelujah.
And we had people who could see the blind, they finally got their sight, and there was a lady there that was on oxygen for 10 years, and she would carry this oxygen, and on the second day, she got healed, and the third day, she gave a testimony that she went all day long. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And we had 500 young adults, the youth. We had 500 of them, or over 500 of them, filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. It was a wonderful, wonderful time, and the presence of God was so heavy. And also, we have a church out there in Ethiopia, Garnet Church. They have come into partnership with us, and they have given us land out there in Ethiopia, and we're going to, by the grace of God, we have put up a Bible school out there and a medical clinic and a guest house that will house people that will come for the Bible, because there is a way of evangelism going out in Ethiopia. People are just eager to hear the word of God, and people are just eager to dedicate their lives to the Lord. So we want to get the Bible school going. So I just thank God that we are back safely, and I thank Pastor Israel for all our support in helping us to go out there. And if you would like to join this mighty move of God, please contact Pastor Israel. Glory be to God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Heard about people Okay, my father, you remember, my father was on that, and it is a terrible thing when you cannot breathe. But when you're talking about people that are lame walking, people that are blind, okay, you know, we tend to, I think sometimes discount that God does do miracles. The bottom line is over, and I have to say over here, we have so much, okay, so much, but when all they have is a word of God, yes. All they have, if they know that if God doesn't do it for them, it is not going to be done. Yes. All right, so, you know, I encourage everybody that when we get ready to go, you're talking about 10,000 people, over 10,000 people that came just because they wanted to hear the word of God. Okay, do not become cynical because America does not want to hear about God, okay, at this point. We need to take this gospel to the ends of the earth. We need to support what it is that they are going to do, both with the Bible College, because we're going to support them with materials that we're going to send over for the Torah, as well as medical help and all of that. So those who are willing to work, okay, and to serve, okay, because that's what we're all about. Yes, you know, I believe the word of God. How many people here believe the word of God? How many people here really, really believe that word of God? All right, so we're going to continue to pray for Ethiopia. Ethiopia is in the middle of what can be a very terrible civil war, okay, at this point, all right? You know, and so we see all over the earth is literally trembling. Okay, trembling, okay, at this point, as the sons of God begin to arise, all right. So anyway, let's keep Christiana, let's keep all of the Minnesota, I say the Minnesota babies, because they are babies in Torah, okay, babies in Torah, and they are going forth and taking the Torah that they have and spreading that Torah throughout the world. So continue to keep them in prayer. Our Monday night prayer call, please lift them up in prayer, okay, for that. All right, we have, I think Ed is next. And Ed will be reading the next article in our Yom Kippur book.
Yom Kippur. Greetings for Yom Kippur. Leviticus 16, 1-34, Numbers 29, 7-11, Isaiah 57, 14-58. Romans 3:21-26. Yom Kippur, also known as the Day of Atonement, is the most holy, solemn day of the year. It is the last day of the High Holy Days, which began 9 days before on Rosh Hashanah. This year, Yom Kippur begins at sundown Wednesday, October
14.
It is a Sabbath day of complete rest throughout synagogues all over the world. People fast and pray and hope the Lord will forgive their sins. In Jewish tradition, it is believed the gates of heaven swing open on Rosh Hashanah and the heavenly record books are open. The 10 days between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur are called the Days of Awe, when the Holy One of Israel examines each soul to see if it is worthy to be inscribed in the Book of Life. On Yom Kippur, the judgment is sealed, the books are closed. Either you are inscribed in the Book of Life or the Book of Death. One long shofar blast sounds at the end of the day as the gates of heaven swing shut and close. Do you know that Yom Kippur means day of covering, or Hebrew kaparot means covering? God is holy, pure, and perfect. Because of sin, mankind is unholy, impure, and imperfect. How then can we enter into the presence of God? We need a covering or atonement for our sins. When Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden and realized they were naked, the fig leaves they sown and war may have covered them in their eyes, but certainly not in God's eyes. In fact, God took an innocent animal and shed its blood to make skins to properly cover them. Do you see the picture here? Sin has to be punished because God is just, and sins cost something, blood. It is blood that makes atonement because of the life, Vayikra of Leviticus 17:11. In fact, according to the Torah, almost everything is purified with blood. Indeed, without the shed of the blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. Messianic Jews, Hebrews 9-22. About 4,000 years ago, God spoke to Moses and said, the 10th day of the 7th month is Yom Kippur. You are to have a holy convocation. You You are to deny yourselves, and you are to bring an offering made by fire to Adonai. You are not to do any work on that day, because it is Yom Kippur, to make atonement for you before Adonai your God. By Riker of Leviticus 23:26. For on this day, atonement will be made for you to purify you. You will be clean before Adonai from all your sins. It is a Shabbat of complete rest for you, and you are to deny yourselves. By Yikra Leviticus 16:29. This special commandment was to be performed in a special place. The God of heaven wanted a place on earth where he could meet, wanted a place on earth where he could meet with the children of Israel. Let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. Shemot of Exodus 25:8. God gave Moses a blueprint to make a portable tabernacle, a Mishkan. Read all about in Shemot of Exodus 25:31. Once a year, the high priests, only those from the tribe of Levi can serve in the Mishkan, had to enter the Holy of Holies. A descendant of Aaron from the tribe of Levi to offer sacrifices for his sins and for the sins of the people of Israel. First, he washed himself and put on a simple white linen garment. Then, with hands full of incense and glowing coals from the altar, the place where the animals were sacrificed, he entered into the Holy of Holies. He sprinkled blood from a bull from him. It was for his household sins, and blood from a male goat, a sin offering for the people on the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark was a wooden box which contained the tablets, Ten Commandments, that God wrote with his own finger. It overlaid with pure gold inside and out. The lid for the ark was called the mercy seat, by the Hebrew capital meaning covering. Two angels of cherubim were fashioned and placed at each side with their wings spread out, covering the ark, facing toward each other. God said in Vayikra of Leviticus 16:2, I appear in the cloud above the ark cover. On Yom Kippur, the high priest literally entered into the divine presence of the Shekinah of God. The high priest also took a scapegoat of Azazel, put his hands on it, and asked God to forgive the people's sin. Then he sent the goat into the wilderness, symbolically taking the people's sins with it. There must have been great relief and rejoicing when the high priest was finished and greeted the people, because they knew their sins had been forgiven or atoned for, and they could enjoy God's presence again for another year. There you have it, a brief summary of Yom Kippur. What does it all have to do with today? Are your sins covered and forgiven? The Mishkan does not presently exist. Animal sacrifices have ceased. But guess what? We still have a high priest. His name is Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah. He came from heaven to earth 2,000 years ago, holy, sinless, perfect, and crucified, and died on a tree and shed his own blood for you, that you might have your sins covered or forgiven. Because he, Yeshua, lives forever, his position as high priest does not pass on to someone else. He is totally able to deliver those who approach God through him. This is a kind of high priest that meets your need, holy, without evil, without stain, set apart from sinners and raised higher than the heavens, one who does not have the daily necessity, like other high priests, of offering up sacrifices first for his own sin and then only for the people, because he offered one sacrifice once and for all by offering himself. Messianic Jews, Hebrews 7:24-27. But when Messiah appeared as a high priest of the good things that are happening already, then through the greater and more perfect tent, which is not man-made, he entered the holiest place once and for all. And he entered not by the means of the blood of goats and calves, but by the means of his own blood. That's setting people free forever. Messianic Jews, that's Hebrews 9:11-12. Yeshua was the final sacrifice for sin. Believers in Yeshua can rejoice on Yom Kippur that we have assurance of forgiveness of sins. God loved you so much that he gave his only begotten Son. Is he your Lord and Savior? Hide or seek. Are you hiding from the presence of the Lord because of sin? Are you seeking him with all your heart, soul, and mind? Seek Adonai while he is available. Call on him while he's still nearby. Yeshua, Yahweh, or Isaiah 55:6. Regardless of what sins you have committed, humbly and sincerely ask God to forgive you and cleanse and wash you with the precious blood. Messiah Yeshua. If you've never asked Yeshua to be the Savior and Lord of your life, let this be your day of atonement. Ask him to come into your heart and life to become the person you were meant to be. You can then rejoice when your name is inscribed in the Lamb's Book of Life. Sheep or goat, Yeshua is coming again. This time he will rule as king. Will you be ready when he comes? When the Son of Man comes in his glory, he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates sheep from goats. The sheep he will place at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you whom my father has blessed, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you from the founding of the world. Matthew 25:31-34. Amen.
Amen. All right. Just real quick before Leroy comes up, go back to the first page of that article. And guess what, guys? I'm going to let you keep these books.
Yeah.
And the reason for it is I have to correct the errors. I don't like putting out something that is not perfect. Okay, so this is really bugging me right now that I didn't catch this. Okay, but anyway, I'm going to let you keep the books. No, you can keep them, and I will correct this, and I'm going to have to reprint all of these for next year. Keep them. Please keep them. Don't get rid of them. Okay, so keep them so that we'll have them for next year. But, all right, second paragraph. In Jewish tradition, it is believed the gates of heaven swing open on Rosh Hashanah, and the heavenly record books are open. The 10 days between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur are called the days of awe. When the Holy One of Israel examines each soul to see if it is worthy to be inscribed in the Book of Life, on Yom Kippur, the judgment is sealed. The books are closed. Either you are inscribed in the Book of Life or Book of Death. One long shofar blast sounds at the end of the day as the gates of heaven swing shut and close. Okay. Just think for a moment where you've seen that actually occur. I just want you to hold on to that thought. Okay, for a moment, because you should be able to relate this to something in the Bible. Okay, so I'm going to bring Leroy up, and then I'm going to come back and give you a lesson, okay, on that.
Shalom.
Shalom.
Please pray that the Holy One will cause the plans and schemes of his enemies to come to naught. That he will send the hornet amongst them, will throw their camps into confusion and chaos, will strike terror in their hearts, and will cause them to flee in seven directions before him. As the seventh month of Nisan, Abib, the month of Jewish redemption and independence. In the Torah, the focal point of Yom Kippur is the cleansing and purification of the temple service, which would create the conditions necessary for God to continue to dwell in our midst. God's divine presence in the home that we have built for him, be it the temple or our hearts, is the true Shalom Bayit. The wholeness and serenity of martial life for which we strive. For this reason, the apex of the divine service of Yom Kippur is performed in the Holy of Holies. On Yom Kippur, our hearts should be focused on ensuring that God's divine presence will continue to dwell between the two cherubim, the symbol of the consummate love between God and Israel, so that they may continue their face-to-face embrace. Thus, the prayers of Yom Kippur are replete with intricate confessions of all personal sins, resembling a heart-to-heart talk with God. We must ensure that our hearts are a pure and befitting dwelling place for God's divine presence. In Judaism, the holiest day of the year is Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. On that day, the nation seeks God forgiveness for sins, both personal and national. But it's interesting, however, it's the day before Yom Kippur, known as Ered Yom Kippur. It represents a person's last opportunity to seek forgiveness from other people before Yom Kippur begins. This is important because in Jewish thought, you must seek forgiveness from other people before you can seek the forgiveness of God. Today we are called to do the same. Jesus pointed out that in order to worship him with all of our heart, we first need to resolve matters with others. In Matthew 5:23-24, he said, if you bring your gift to the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. even in a manner so basic as our giving, the ability to truly worship God is hindered by the reality of relationships broken by our wrong actions, attitudes, and words. So that all worship can be pleasing and acceptable to God, let us make every effort to be reconciled to one another today. Have you hurt a friend or brother? Go at once and make this thing and make things right. From your heart, say, "Please forgive me." How these words bring God delight. D-day-han. An offense against your neighbor is a fence between you and God. Shalom.
All right, if you go back two pages. Okay, we're going to go over the themes for this time frame. All right, so we started out the beginning of this month. And give me a minute, I just need to turn to. Okay. We started out with Yom Teruah or Rosh Hashanah, the season of repentance. All right, Rosh Hashanah, Rosh meaning head, Hashanah, the year, head of the year. Birthday of the world, it is said this is when Adam was created. Yom Teruah, the day of the awakening blast or the feast of trumpets. Yom Hadin, the day of judgment. Hamalek, the coronation of the Messiah. Yom Hazikaron, the day of remembrance or memorial. It is the time of Jacob's trouble or the birth pangs of the Messiah. Okay, it is the opening of the gates, the Kiddushin Nesuin, the wedding ceremony, the resurrection of the dead, the rapture, Natsal, the last trump, Shofar, you've heard Paul talk about that, and Yom HaKaseh, the hidden day. On Yom Kippur, my friend Beth, you know my friend Beth, her father passed away. Okay, not Yom Kippur, I'm sorry, Yom Teruah. Okay, Rosh Hashanah. Very difficult time for them. Thank God she was able to be up there with her father, okay, when he took his last breath. But when I saw the day that he actually passed away, I was saying, boy, I wish I could have been up there to do his funeral, okay? Because he passed away on the day that represents the resurrection of the dead, when the dead in Christ will rise. He was a believer. He passed away on the day that was the day to meet the king. You understand what I'm saying? He passed away on the day that the gates of heaven were open. You understand? And so when she came back, I told her that. And she texted me, give me all the scriptures and everything, because she's going to share that with her family. She was so excited. She never knew, you know, any of that before. But that, in taking a very difficult situation and turning it towards the glory of God, you understand the glory of God, and to be able to comfort someone that they would actually pass away on the day that the gates of heaven were open, where he would meet the king, where the dead in Christ are scheduled to rise. Hallelujah! Okay, hallelujah! You know, how profound is that? How profound is that? To comfort someone who is mourning. Isn't that what we're supposed to be doing? Yes. Okay, yes. Comfort those who mourn. And leaving his widow behind, they had been married, God knows, they were in their 80s, and I think they got married in their like early 20s or so. So over 60 years, it's a very difficult situation. But this way, knowing that they can have some comfort, that it's kind of hard when you think, God, where is God in this time? Oh my gosh, where is God? Okay, he is all over this, you know, right now. Yom Kippur, the theme is the Day of Atonement. It is where we meet God face to face. I should have put up here, show me your face. Okay, why is it a face-to-face meeting? Because it is the time when sin is judged. See, that's why God said, you cannot see my face. Because his face is judgment, his back is mercy and goodness. You always want to meet his goodness and mercy. Because sin is immediately judged. But today is the day when you meet him face to face. I need to let that selah a moment. Okay, right now. This is a face-to-face meeting with him. Or it is also called the day or the great day. So when you see that terminology in the Bible, know that they're talking about Yom Kippur. Paul is all over that. If you read, that's why I say, if you don't know the Torah, the epistles of Paul really don't make much sense.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it is not until you know the Torah that you fully understand what Paul is even talking about. Okay, in that, why? Because Paul uses this type of language which was very familiar to them. You understand? Now, this language was familiar to them. Why? They were Gentiles, so how was it familiar to them? He taught them Torah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, he taught them Torah. And it's because the church was not taught Torah that they came up with all this craziness about Paul. All right? And so anyway, it is also called the fast day. Why? Because it is the day that we are commanded to fast. In the book of Acts, it talks about Paul making a journey that occurred after the fast. So you know the time frame of that journey was during Yom Kippur, after the Yom Kippur. But once again, if you don't know Torah, you don't know that Paul was celebrating the Torah, okay, all the while. It is the day of the great shofar, okay, that great trumpet, okay, Ni'ilah, the closing of the gates. Now, okay, when we read that article, I asked you, do you know where that language is used at? And I don't know if any of you thought about the book of Revelation. Because remember, the book of Revelation, we are rehearsing this right now. This is a rehearsal, okay, where you are meeting God face to face. We're rehearsing for this time. By the book of Revelation, everything has to, this is opening night. Revelation is opening night. So all the rehearsals are done with. You either get it right or not. Okay, so in Revelation chapter 20, okay, in Revelation chapter 20, I'll just read a couple of verses. I'll just start at verse 11. We'll go into this more in a Revelation study. But verse number 11, and I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it, whose face the earth and the heaven fled away. What is today? What is Yom Kippur? Face to face. Okay? And there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were open, and another book was open, which is the book of life. Remember, Rosh Hashanah is the time when your name is inscribed in the book of life, book of intermediates, okay, book of the dead. All right? And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. Remember, there is a 10-day period or 9-day period in between, okay, that particular time. So he said the book of life, the books were open, and another book, the book of life. So books, that's two books, book of life, three books open. Your name is inscribed on either the book of life, the book of the intermediates, or those that are lukewarm, okay, or the book of the wicked, all right? So during that time, that 10 days is mercy for who? Which set of books? The intermediate, because now you have time to make up your mind or get it right, okay? That's mercy, okay? But by this end of this time, which is today, today Yom Kippur, all right, you see this in, let's go to verse 13. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works. According to their works. So this is what has been going on during this time. And death and hell were cast into where? The lake of fire. This is the second death. And whoso was not found in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. So what winds up happening, the book of life, you get to experience, okay, chapter 21. The book of the intermediates, where do you go? Where do you go?
Lake of fire.
No, you go one place, the lake of fire.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone, the Bible says, whosoever was not found written in the book of life is cast into the lake of fire. So we already think about the wicked, but what about those who are
lukewarm?
What about the lukewarm? Okay, that's why Yeshua gives that warning to the church. I would that you be hot or cold. Hot or cold, but if you are lukewarm, I will do what? Spew you out. Do you understand what I'm saying? So that's what this day is all about. Your name is either written in the book of life. Now, we're rehearsing, right? So guess what? Rehearsals are going on and on and on. Guess what? For some people, I've seen this be the last rehearsal. Okay, I've seen it be the last rehearsal. Okay, and so that's why it's so important to understand the cycles of God. And that is not meant to put fear. Only the wicked need to fear God, okay? Everybody else should be rejoicing. Because all you have to do is do what? Confess your sins. He's faithful and just to forgive your sins and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. That's what we are celebrating, the fact that the Lamb died, but Yeshua is alive in us. So we celebrate that. But you need to know why you are celebrating and what you are celebrating. Because what winds up happening, this is a yearly cycle, right? So once again, okay, things are decided on Rosh Hashanah. Your income for next year has already been decided. Okay, it has been decided. Now, if you don't like where you are, you have 9 days to negotiate change in terms, okay? But by Yom Kippur, bang, that's it. And starting at the end of Tabernacles, the judgments that are executed in or entered into on Yom Kippur begin being executed. So that's why it's so important, why I focus on, guys, do you know what time it is? Do you know what day it is? Do you know what you're supposed to be doing here? Because when you don't pay attention and you go into another year, guess what? I'm hands off. I'm hands off. The only thing you can get at that point is mercy. Hopefully someone will have a bumper crop so that you can glean from the corners of the field. You understand what I'm saying? I see it in people's lives constantly. So that's why I say sometimes, and people think it's hard, you know whether somebody's going to succeed or whether they're not going to succeed. Yeshua knew that by a fig tree. You understand what I'm saying? Okay, so these things are meant to teach us. The Bible says, Paul says, that they were given to you for examples, okay? And this is the word of God. Understand something. Nobody here goes around blaspheming God's name. Everyone says, right, right, right. No, when you refuse to believe his word is magnified above all his name. So when you choose not to believe his word, you have blasphemed God. The penalty for blasphemy is? So there are some times, okay, there are some times that you can know. Don't believe. That's why we stay so much in the word of God. Why we rehearse, you know, wearing the white even. Why? Because that is what? The purity. The people were coming before God because why? They needed something from God. Now, if you don't need anything from God, maybe you're going to waste your time. Okay, you go ahead and leave now. But I do. Okay, I do. And I'm quite sure everybody here, this year, if you don't need something right now, this year, you are. Okay, you are. So this is a time of rejoicing. Now, we study the Bible, what? Biblically, culturally, and historically, which is why I think the good reason for me to just go ahead and give you these books so that you can use this to teach other people. Let's go to the article, okay, after the one Leroy read, Miracles in the Talmud, recorded after the crucifixion. Okay? All right, the Talmud tells us in Tractate Yom 39b that the rabbis found out on Yom Kippur that God's Shekinah glory no longer dwelt in the temple based upon four definite incidents that occurred within the temple. 40 years before the Holy Temple was destroyed, the following things happened. Now, understand something. We study the Bible historically, all right? This is written in their history. Written in their history. So these are not any cunningly devised fables. These are things that are written in history, which is why you need to understand these things. One, that happened, the lot for the Yom Kippur goat ceased to be supernatural. The red cord of wool that used to change to white as a symbol of God's forgiveness. Remember, it would have been dipped in red, but changed to white. White is what? Purity. So that meant your sin had been forgiven. But 40 years before, it stopped changing. They had had a sign up until that time. It stopped changing. It now remained red and would never again turn white to show God had forgiven Israel's sins. What happened 40 years prior to the destruction of Hiram? was crucified. The nation had rejected him. Go to Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12 is where you flip a switch, where they refused to believe, and now he's just after the remnant, okay, at this point. Okay, because the nation refused to believe. Okay, now there comes a time, a point of no return. You see that at the end of Acts with Paul. What does Paul say? If you remember, we did read that. He says, okay, you guys, I'm tired of this. I am now going to the Gentiles. The kingdom has been taken, and it's going to the Gentiles. Does that mean he rejected the Jews? No, because Paul later teaches, hey, I broke some of them off and put the other ones to sleep so that you can come in. Okay? So there will be a time of reconciliation where everything is attached where it's supposed to be. But their rejection wound up being a blessing for us so that we could come into the Torah. I'll say Torah. Okay, come into his teaching and understanding. Instruction, rather. Number two, the lot for God's sacrificial goat no longer came up in the priest's right hand as it always had done from the time Yom Kippur was instituted. The western candle in the candlestick in the sanctuary that had always been first lit and remained lit when others went out would no longer burn continually. What is that middle? What is that middle one representing? It represents Yeshua. Okay, so the candle that was used to light all the other candles no longer stayed lit. Okay? And the doors of the temple opened and closed by themselves. These doors were made of heavy brass and required 20 Levites to open or close them. That in itself is a scary thing. But these are things that were written in history of what happened. See, that's why we cannot take what it is that we have lightly. Okay, because once again, it is written in the Bible, but it's all also recorded in history that they recognize something happened. Okay, something happened. What happened that would cause all of these signs? Now, a whole lot of people today are in synagogues and Orthodox synagogues and everything, and praise God, they are. But part of their ceremony, because they no longer sacrifice, does anybody know what they do on Yom Kippur? They take a chicken and bring the chicken around their heads. Okay? All right. And so, you know, we... Many times when I see this, people running over, people who are believers running over to participate, and it's like, chicken, really? Okay, really? This is where we've come to now. Okay, because they do not believe in Yeshua. All right, so they are seeking a righteousness of their own doing as opposed to the righteousness that is afforded in Christ. The good news is that, what does the Bible say? All Israel will be saved. So there is a coming a reckoning where they will recognize him whom they pierced and accept him at that point. But in the meantime, we have gotten the best. You understand? We have gotten the best. So very often when we're looking for other things, you're going to step into something that, wait a minute, why are we swinging the chicken? That's not salvation there, guys. Put the chicken down. Leave the chicken alone. Okay. You know? But that's a sad thing. To me, it's a sad thing, okay, that would be taking place. You would think that that would take place of, instead of accepting Yeshua as Lord and Savior. But then again, the craziness in the church is one reason because of that. All right, now, just reading this, in the centuries following the destruction of the temple in Israel, 70 AD, the Jewish people began writing two versions of the Jewish thought, religious history and commentary. One was written in Palestine and became known as the Jerusalem Talmud, and the other was written in Babylon, known as the Babylonian Talmud. Now, I have down there the Essential Talmud, okay, written, and the Babylonian Talmud was actually written by Africans. Abba Ben Ibo, they were from Nigeria, okay, they were Ibos, okay, from the tribe of Ibos that did the Babylonian Talmud. Now, a Babylonian Talmud means there were a whole lot of Jews in Babylon, right? Mm-hmm. Hello? That means a whole lot of Jews didn't leave Babylon. Mm-hmm. You understand? It was a remnant that went out during the days of Cyrus and everything like that. Okay, but a whole lot of Jews stayed in Babylon, which leads me to believe, I bet you a whole lot of Jews stayed in Egypt, too. Probably not everybody came out willingly. All right? So, okay, we read in the Jerusalem Talmud, 40 years before the destruction of the temple, the western light went out, the crimson thread remained crimson, and the lot for the Lord always came up in the left hand. They would close the gates of the temple by night and get up in the morning and find them wide open. That's in Jacob Nessner, the Jerusalemite, pages 156 to 157. The temple was destroyed in 70 CE. Okay? A similar passage in the Babylonian Talmud states, our rabbis taught, during the last 40 years before the destruction of the temple, the lot for the Lord did not come up in the right hand, nor did the crimson-colored strap become white, nor did the westernmost light shine, and the doors of the Hekel temple would open by themselves. That's the Songchino version, Yoma 39b. What are these passages talking about? Since both Talmuds recount the same information, this indicates the knowledge of these events was accepted by the widespread Jewish community. I want some of these actually read. Okay, read by other people here. The miracle of the lot. All right, Lena, can you come up and read the miracle of the lot? Christiana, if you could, after Lena gets finished, read the miracle of the red strip. And I'll choose someone else for the temple doors.
Oh, it's great to be back.
Yay. Yay. Give Lena a rich hand. Yay!
I'll be reading page one, the miracles of the lot. The first of these miracles concerns the random choosing of the lot, which was cast on the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur. The lot chosen determined which of two goats would be for the Lord and which goat would be for the Aziel, or scapegoat. During the 200 years before 30 CE, when the high priest picked one of two stones, again this selection was governed by chance. And each year the priest would select a black stone as often as a white stone. But for 40 years in a row, beginning in 30 Common Era, the high priest picked the black stone. The odds against this happening are astronomical, 2 to the 40th power. In other words, the chances of this occurring are 1 in approximately 5,479,548,800, or about 5.5 billion to 1. By comparison, your chances of winning your local, state, or municipal run cash lottery would be much more favorable. The lot for Aziel, the black stone, contrary to all the laws of chance, came up 40 times in a row from 30 to 70 AD. This was considered a dire event and signified something had fundamentally changed in this Yom Kippur ritual. This casting of lots is also accompanied by yet another miracle, which is described next.
Christiana?
Yes.
Okay.
The miracle of the red strip. The second miracle concerns the crimson strip of cloth tied to the Azrael's boat. A portion of this red cloth was also removed from the goat and tied to the temple door. And each year, the red cloth of the temple door turned white, as if to signify the atonement of another Yom Kippur was acceptable to the Lord. This annual event happened on the 30th, when the cloth then remained crimson each year for the time of the temple destruction. This undoubtedly caused much fear and consternation among the Jews. This traditional practice is linked to Israel confessing its sins and ceremonially placing this nation's sins upon an was then removed by this book set. Sin was represented by the red cloth, the red color of the cloth, the color of love. But the color remained crimson. That is, Israel's sin was not been paddled and made white. As God told Israel through Isaiah the prophet, come, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sin is scarlet, crimson, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as white as wool. Isaiah 1:15. The clear indication is that the whole community has lost the Lord's essential relation to something that occurs in eternity. The yearly atonement achieved through the typical Yom Kippur observance was not being realized as expected. Atonement apparently was to be gained in some other way. Who or what could provide the atonement for another year? Concerning the crimson script, though not mentioned in the scriptures and long before fairly. During the 40 years, Simon the righteous was high priest. As a crimson thread was, which was associated with his coffin, also turned white when he entered the temple's innermost, Holy of Holies. The people noticed it. Also, they noticed that the lock of the Lord, the white lock, came off for 40 straight years. During Simon's priesthood. They noticed that the Lord's priest by the priest after Simon will sometimes be black and sometimes white, and that the crimson thread would sometimes come white and sometimes not. The Jews came to believe that if the crimson thread comes white, that God approved the day of atonement. And that Israel could be assured that God forgave their sins. But after 30 years, the crimson thread never turned white again for 40 years. Still, the destruction of the temple and the cessation of all temple rituals. What did the Jewish nation do in 30 to merit such shame as Yom Kippur? By some accounts, on April 5, 30, that is, on the 14th day, on the 14th of Nisan, the day of Passover sacrifice, the Messiah, Yeshua, was cut off from Israel, himself put to death as a sacrifice for sin. So this event, there is a transference of the atonement, now no longer achieved the two goals as offered. Like an innocent Passover lamb, the Messiah was put to death through no fault was found in him. But unlike temple sacrifices or the Yom Kippur event as detailed above, where sin is only covered over for a time, the Messiah sacrifice, the messianic sacrifice, comes with the promise of forgiveness of sins. To grace given by God and to those who accept a personal relationship with Messiah. This is essential, a one-time event for each person's lifetime and not for continual series of annual observances and animal sacrifices. The mechanism provided the forgiveness of sin changed fairly.
Temple doors. The next miracle which the Jewish authorities acknowledged was that of the temple doors, swung open every night of their own accord. This too occurred for 40 years, beginning in 30 CE. The leading Jewish authorities of that time, Yohanan being Zechariah, declared that this was a sign of impending doom, that the temple itself would be destroyed. The Jerusalem Talmud states, said Rabbi Yohanan ben Zakkaiah to the temple, O temple, why do you frighten us? We know that you will end up destroyed, but it has been said, open your doors, Alebanon, that fine may devour your cedars. Zechariah 11, verse 1, so does 6. Yohanan ben Zakkaiah was a leader of the Jewish community during the time of following the destruction of the temple in 70 CE, when the Jewish government was transferred to Jamania, some 30 miles west of Jerusalem. Might the doors have opened to also signify that all may know, enter the temple even to its innermost holy sessions. Evidence supported by the miracles inscribed above suggests the Lord's presence had departed from the temple. This was no longer a just place for a high priest alone, but the door swung open for all to enter the Lord's house of worship.
The miracle of the temple menorah. The fourth miracle was the most important lamp of the seven candlesticks menorah in the temple went out and would not shine. Every night for 40 years, over 12,500 nights in a row, the main lamp of the temple lampstand menorah went out of its own accord. No matter what attempts and precautions the priests took to safeguard against this event. Ernest Martin states, in fact, we are told in the Talmud, at the dusk, the lamps that were until in the daytime, the middle four lamps remained until, unlit, while the two eastern lamps normally stayed lit during the day, were to be relit from the flames of the western lamp, which was a lamp that was supposed to stay lit all the time. It was like the eternal flame that we see today in some national monuments. This western lamp was to be kept lit at all times. For that reason, the priest kept extra reservoirs of olive oil and other implements to ready supply to make sure that the western lamp, under all circumstances, would stay lit. But what happened in the 40 years from the very year Messiah said the physical temple would be destroyed? Every night for 40 years, the western lamp went out, and this in spite of the priests each evening preparing in a special way the western lamp so that it would remain constantly burning all night. The significance of the year CE 30, Ernest Martin Research Update, April 1994, page 4. Again, the odds against the lamp continually going out are astronomical. Something out of the ordinary was going on. The light of the menorah, representing contact with God, His Spirit, and His presence, was now removed. This special demonstration occurred during, this special demonstration occurred starting with the crucifixion of the Messiah.
All right, how many of you knew that before? How many of you knew that this was a historical event that has been written about in history? You understand why it's so important that you study the Bible, not just biblically, but culturally as well as historically, so that you can see how this plays out all the way through history. So, in conclusion, it should be clear to any reasonable mind that there is no natural way to explain all these four signs connected with the year 30 CE. The only possible explanation has to be supernatural. After 30 CE, the death of the Messiah, great trouble and awesome trials begin to come upon the Jewish nation. Yeshua himself foretold it as he was led away to be crucified. Yeshua warned the woman of Jerusalem, But Yeshua, turning to them, said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For indeed the days are coming in which they will say, 'Blessed are the barren wombs that never bore and breasts which never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do these things in the green wood, what will be done in the dry?" That's from Luke 23, verses 28-31. We also remember how Yeshua, when they were looking in Matthew chapter 23, they asked about the temple. They were bragging about the temple. And what did Yeshua say? "Not one stone. Every stone is going to be overturned," okay, with this. Okay, so he was giving them a message there. And we see that in history, almost to the very time. 40 is the number of what?
Testing.
40 years later, what winds up happening, the temple is destroyed. Now, he was crucified in 33. Okay, so 30 represents, remember, when he began his ministry. Okay, so from the time he began his ministry was a time of testing. Now, how that sort of compares, remember, to Moses. They come out of Israel. They are around the mountain for how long? 2 years and about 2 years and 6 months or so, 11 months, okay, or so. Then they go to Kadesh Barnea, and we know what happens at Kadesh Barnea, all right? And then 38 years later, okay, is the 40-year period there. So we see a very similar period within the time frame of Yeshua passing as well as Moses and that particular generation, because 40 is a generation. All of this is just simply meant to let you know what you're doing is for real.
Yes.
What you believe in for is for real.
Yes.
Yeshua is not just some made-up character, okay, that somebody in their mind made up. Yes. There is historical evidence, whether anyone wants to believe it or not. The whole point is it is written in your history,
yes. Yes.
Okay, that it does what? Confirms what God already said with his mouth, okay,
yes.
What happened to the nation. So, when we take an objective look at the events of 30 CE, who can doubt that it was indeed the true year of the crucifixion and resurrection of the true Messiah God sent to Israel? Who can deny that he is the one and only true Messiah? Who else has fulfilled all the prophecies of the Old Testament, including the amazing prophecy of Daniel 9 and the 70 weeks coming at the very year predicted for the Messiah to appear? All right, so that's historically. Now, we're going to begin to get into, okay, some prayer, all right? I'm going to teach about the Shemona Esra, all right? Shemona Esra is an absolutely beautiful, beautiful prayer, all right? And we're going to look at the Lord's Prayer and compare it to the Shemona Esra. So let us review the prayer that is sometimes called the Lord's Prayer. Actually, it was his instructions. Does everyone know his instructions on how to pray? The Lord's Prayer is actually later on. Okay, in the garden. All right, that's the Lord's Prayer. This is his instructions to pray to his disciples. He said, "After this manner, therefore, ye pray." What seems to be definite passages or stages to Yeshua's instructions can be distinguished as six phases or stages of communication with God. Okay, so it's important for you to know how to pray the way that he instructed his disciples to pray. Yeshua's instruction to approach God was first to what? Worship or praise. Second, surrender. Third, to bring your request. Fourth, to be in the attitude of repentance. Fifth, to pray for guidance. And sixth, to be close with worship and praise. The Lord's Prayer is actually a shortened form of the Shemona Esra, the 18 blessings, or what is also known as the Amidah, which means standing. You have to know how the pieces fit together in order to catch the interlocking theme. Although Shemona Esra means 18, 8 plus 10, there are actually 19. Number 12, the prayer against informers, was added during the Roman occupation at the close of the first century CE, yet the name of the prayer was not changed. The first three and the last three Barakot blessings are stages of prayer as we approach God and descend from our petitions. They contain blessings, praise, and worship. The middle paragraphs plead for wisdom, repentance, forgiveness, etc. Quoting from the Encyclopedia of Jewish Concepts, Shemona Esra, the Shemona Esra prayer is on the central element in the three daily prayer services, Shacharit, Minha,
Simcha and Ma'ariv. It is spoken of in the Talmud as tefillah, the prayer par excellence, on account of its importance and its antiquity. According to tradition, it was composed by the members of the great assembly who flourished at the early period of the Second Temple. So, the Shemona Ezra is a good prayer, okay, for you to pray on a daily basis. Originally, the Shemona Ezra denoting 18 consisted of 18 benedictions. In its present form, however, there are 19. The addition of the paragraph concerning slanderers and enemies of the people was made towards the end of the first century at the direction of Rabban Gamliel II, the head of the Sanhedrin Yavne. The Shemona Ezra is now generally referred to as the Amidah, standing, because it is recited in a standing posture. The middle paragraphs of the weekday Shemona Ezra contain petitions for the fulfillment of our needs. They plead for wisdom, repentance, forgiveness, deliverance, healing, prosperity. Anybody need any of that here? Okay, all right, I just wanted to make sure. Okay, you paid attention, okay? The ingathering of the dispersed, restoration of justice, protection of the upright, rebuilding of Jerusalem, the Messianic era, and acceptance of prayer. All of these petitions are on behalf of the entire community. Petitions for personal needs may be inserted at their appropriate place, as when one reaches the 18th blessing, which reads, "Heal us, O Lord, and we shall be healed. Save us, and we shall be saved." After the Shemona Ezra, the following meditation is added. O God, guard my tongue from evil and my lips from speaking falsehood. Open my heart to thy Torah, that my soul may follow thy command. Save with thy right hand and answer me. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy presence, O Lord, my Redeemer. Okay, now, the following is a brief outline of the Shemona Ezra, taken back to the sources by Barry W. Holtz, page 415. In addition, we have listed beside the appropriate Shemona Ezra Barakot the corresponding theme and verse of the six stages of the Lord's Prayer. One of the reasons for teaching this lesson is, once again, so you can make it relevant to those who don't understand why you're doing what it is you're doing. So, remember, Yeshua taught Jews, right? They would have been familiar with certain things. We weren't given the Torah and are not familiar with the culture. So the Shemona Ezra is a cultural thing. So what we are doing here, making all of this relevant by what exploring it in the culture as well as the Bible as well as history. So that, guess what? No matter how you turn it, it's staying the same. Okay, it stays the same. So, you know, we turn some things in when we were in the church, and we began turning them now, and they're completely different. Okay, so now, let's look at Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 through 15. And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. Okay? But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father, which is in secret, and thy Father, which seeth in secret, shall reward thee openly. Guess what, guys? Your tallit is also called a prayer closet. Okay? So when you place the tallit over you, you're in your closet. Okay? It's called a prayer closet also, so know that. All right? I'm going to try to find where I can get some nice tallits. I'm doing some research, and guys, I want to see if I can get you some tallit katans, which are the undershirts that have the fringes, that have the tzitzit on them, because you have just inspired me. Okay, Leroy, okay. That is nice. That reminds me of what's at the bottom of the priestly garment, actually. That's what, and the colors are also. So you've inspired me to do that. I got to look for these tallits and the tallit katan for the men. So anyway, continuing this, all right? He goes, when you pray, use not vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. In other words, you don't have to use a whole lot of words, guys. All right? Be ye not therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things ye have need of before you ask him. After this manner, therefore, ye pray. or thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. For if ye forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if ye forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. What happened to once saved, always saved? Okay? You need to, and since I'm giving you these, you can feel free when you want to highlight in them. You do that anyway. Okay? Matthew chapter 6, verse 14 and 15 are two key verses to understanding the kingdom. You choose to have unforgiveness. Okay? You choose to not forgive someone for something they've done to you. It eliminates your ability to go before God and not have him remember what you did to him. You understand what I'm saying? That, I think unforgiveness is the biggest sin in the church today. And that is one reason why there is so much sickness in the church. Unforgiveness. Okay? Now, states of the Lord's Prayer. Okay? On your left side is Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 through 13. And then the Shemona Ezra on the second. So, can we have a microphone? I need the microphone. Yeah, Brad has it. Brad's holding the microphone hostage. Thank you, Brad. Steve, I'm going to have you take the mic, and I will read the Lord's Prayer from Matthew, and then you read beside with the Shemona Ezra when I instruct you. Okay? All right? No, you can stand up here. Okay, the Lord's Prayer, worship, verse number 9. After this manner ye pray, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Can you do the Shemona Ezra sign?
Okay, Shemona Ezra. Elohim is the protector of the forefathers. Elohim is the power that makes for salvation. Elohim is the source of holiness, foreknowledge.
All right. Repentance, that's verse number 12. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors.
For the strength to repent for forgiveness.
Request, verse 11. Give us this day our daily bread.
For relief from affliction, for healing, for bounty of the land and material prosperity, for the ingathering of the exiles into the Holy Land.
Restoration, verse 10. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven.
For the establishment of the reign of the true justice, building of Jerusalem, for the coming of the Messiah, for the acceptance of our prayers, and for the restoration of the Jerusalem sanctuary.
Protection for the righteous, verse 12 was not in the original 18. Go ahead.
Against slanders and informers, for the support and protection of the righteous.
And then thanksgiving and praise, verse 13. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Gratitude as man's response to Elohim's work in the world and for Shalom.
All right, all right. And if we can all stand now, we're all going to read the Shemona Ezra together. Okay. And this is the English translation of original Hebrew prayers. Before we begin, if somebody feels faint or whatever, if you really need some water, you can get some water. Okay, with that. I'm not going to have anyone falling out just to prove a point. Okay, so if you get really, you know, feel faint or whatever, sit down, do what you have to do. If you're on medication, please take your medication according to your health professional's directions. If that means with food, you get a little something. We have something here that we can scrounge up somewhere, okay, to give you.
Called the Daniel's Diet.
Oh, so we at least a little something. Anyway, let's start. Blessed are thou, Yahweh, our Elohim, and Elohim of our fathers, Elohim of Abraham, Elohim of Isaac, and Elohim of Jacob. The great, mighty, and awesome Elohim, Elohim Supreme, who extends loving kindness and his thy might is eternal, O Yahweh, who revives the dead, powerful in saving, who makes the wind to blow and the rain to fall, who sustains the living with loving kindness, who revives the dead with great mercy, who supports the falling, heals the sick, frees the captive, and keeps faith with the dead. Who is like thee, Almighty, and who resembles thee, O King, who can bring death and give life? Thou art holy, and thy name is holy, and those who are holy shall praise thee every day. Blessed art thou, Yahweh, the holy Elohim. Thou grantest knowledge to man, and teachest understanding to humans. From thine own self, favor us with knowledge, understanding, and sense. Blessed art thou, Yahweh, giver of knowledge. Return us, our Father, to thy Torah, and draw us closer, our King, to thy worship, and bring us back before thee in complete repentance. Blessed art thou, Yahweh, who desires repentance. Forgive us, our Father, for we have sinned. Pardon us, our King, for we have transgressed. For thou art a pardoner and forgiver. Blessed art thou, Yahweh, gracious one who forgives abundantly. Look upon us in our suffering and fight our struggles. Redeem us speedily for thy name's sake. For thou art a mighty redeemer. Blessed art thou, Yahweh, redeemer of Israel. Heal us, O Yahweh, and we shall be healed. Save us, and we shall be saved, for thou art our glory. Send complete healing for our every illness, for thou, divine King, art the faithful, merciful physician. Blessed art thou, Yahweh, who heals the sick of his people Israel. Bless this year for us, our Elohim, and all its very produce, that it be for good. Provide dew and rain as a blessing on the face of the earth, and satisfy us with goodness and bless us this year with good years. Blessed art thou, Yahweh, who blesses the years. Sound the great shofar to proclaim our freedom. Lift up a banner for the ingathering of our exiles, and bring us together from the four corners of the earth. Blessed art thou, Yahweh, gathers together the dispersed of his people Israel. Restore our judges as at first, and our counselors as in the beginning, removing from us sorrow and sighing. Rule over us, thou alone, O Yahweh, with kindness and mercy, and vindicate us in the judgment. Blessed art thou, Yahweh, King, who loves righteousness and judgment. For slanderers, let there be no hope, and let all wickedness instantly perish. May all thine enemies be quickly cut off. And as for the malicious, swiftly uproot, break, cast down, and subdue quickly in our day. Blessed art thou, Yahweh, who breaks the power of his enemies and subdues the malicious. Number 13. On the righteous and the saintly, on the elders of thy people, the house of Israel, and on their surviving scholars, and on the true proselyte, and on ourselves, let thy compassion flow, O Yahweh our Elohim. Grant a good reward to all who sincerely trust in thy name. Place our lot with them forever, and let us not be shamed, for in thee do we trust. Blessed art thou, O Yahweh, our support and the security of the righteous. To Jerusalem, thy city, return with compassion, and dwell within it as thou promised. Rebuild it as soon in our day, an everlasting structure, and speedily establish in the midst of the throne of David. Blessed art thou, Yahweh, builder of Jerusalem. The offspring of thy servant David, quickly cause to flourish and lift up his power by thy deliverance, for thy deliverance do we constantly hope. Blessed art thou, Yahweh, who makes the glory of deliverance to flourish. Hear our voice, O Yahweh. Yahweh our Elohim, show compassion and mercy to us. Accept our prayers with mercy and favor, for thou art an Elohim who hears prayers and supplications. Favorably receive, O Yahweh our Elohim, thy people Israel and their prayer. Restore the worship to thy temple in Zion. Receive with love and favor the offerings of Israel and their prayer. And may the worship of thy people Israel always be favorably received by thee. May our eyes behold thy return to Zion. Blessed art thou, Yahweh, who restores his divine presence to Zion. We give thanks unto thee, who art the Yahweh, our Elohim, and Elohim of our fathers for all eternity. Thou art the strength of our lives, the shield of our deliverance. In every generation we shall thank thee and declare thy praise for our lives that are entrusted in thy hand, and for our souls that are in thy care, and for thy miracles that are daily with us, and for thy wondrous deeds and goodness that occur at all times, evening, morning, and noon. Thou art the benevolent one, for thy mercies are never ended, the compassionate one, for thy deeds of kindness do not stop. Always have we placed our hope in thee. For all this, O our King, may thy name be always blessed and exalted forever and ever. All the living will thank thee and praise thy name in truth. O Elohim, our eternal salvation and help, blessed art thou, Yahweh, whose name is goodness. It is pleasing to give thanks to thee. Establish peace, well-being, blessing, grace, loving kindness, and mercy upon us and upon all Israel. Thy people, for by the light of thy presence have you given us, O Yahweh our Elohim, a Torah of life, love of kindness, justice, blessing, compassion, life, and peace. It is good in thy sight to bless thy people Israel at all times and in every hour with thy peace. Blessed art thou, Yahweh, who blessed his people Israel with peace. After the Shemona Ezra, the following meditation is added altogether. My God, guard my tongue from evil and my lips from speaking falsehood. Open my heart to thy Torah, that my soul may follow thy command. Save with thy right hand and answer me. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy presence, O Yahweh, my Redeemer. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. All right, for the sake of the tape, Facebook, and everything else, we're going to take a 10-minute break, okay? I need everyone to sign off of the phone and then sign back on, because we do not want one continuous recording, okay? So everyone sign off of the phone who is on and then sign back on. What time is it? Can we move a little bit so I can see?
12:20.
Okay, at 12:30. At 12:30, sign back on. This will give everybody a chance to get some things together. Our next phase, we're going to do blessings and curses. If you're on the phone, what you need to do now is to get together your hand washing. Okay, and what you need is a pitcher, a bowl, and if you have some paper towels, okay, to dry the hands on, and then also some anointing oil. So this will give you 10 minutes to get your hand washing station up that we're going to do in the next phase of our service. So we'll be back online exactly at 12:30. All right, thank you.